Hello everyone, welcome back to another session in Dentistry and more. So we are continuing our prosthodontic sessions. So today's topic is the rest and rest seats. So today's session, we'll be discussing in detail about various types of rests and rest seats, the preparation of rest seats, its properties, advantages and disadvantages. So as we all know, rests are kept on tooth, restoration, onlay, or enamel. So appropriate use of teeth requires consideration as to how best to engage teeth for the supportive qualities. So the most effective resistance can be provided if the tooth is stressed along its long axis. So suppose this is our tooth, so it should be the resistance can be provided if the tooth is stressed along its long axis. So it should be parallel to the long axis. So the prosthetic framework should engage the tooth in a manner that encourages axial loading. This is the axial loading. So the use of rest with removable partial denture processes, which was developed by Bonneville in 1899. As per definition given by GPT, rest is a rigid extension of a RPD that contacts the occlusal, incisal, cingulum or lingual surface of a tooth or restoration, the surface of which is commonly prepared to receive it. Whereas a rest seat, it is a prepared recess in a tooth or restoration created to receive the occlusal, incisal, cingulum or lingual rest. So classification according to McCracken, the basis of tooth surface prepared to receive them, can classify it as occlusal, cingulum rest, then incisal rest and lingual rest. This is based on McCracken. Whereas according to Stewart, he classified on the basis of function they serve as primary or secondary. Okay, secondary is also known as auxiliary rest. And another one more classification is there, that is anterior and posterior rest. So what are the basic functions of rest? The first function is to provide resistance against the occlusal load, then to direct forces of mastication parallel to the long axis of the abutment tooth and to maintain the retentive terminal of the clasp arm in its intended position, then to prevent the denture base from seating past its intended position, then to provide the lateral stability against undue horizontal stress to the soft tissue of the ridges, then to close a small space between teeth by bridging the space using occlusal rest, to maintain the occlusal contact with opposing teeth to prevent extrusion of abutment teeth, to help where tipping or rotation of tooth has impaired functional occlusion, and to provide indirect retention using auxiliary rest. So these are basic functions of rest. So what are the basic considerations while preparing a rest and rest seat? The first thing is, forces that are applied to a RPD must be transferred to the supporting teeth and tissues in a atraumatic fashion. There should not be any trauma while transferring the force to the supporting structures, and rest should be sturdily placed in properly prepared rest seat. Sturdy placement. These are basic considerations. Then rest seat should be within the confines of the greatest tooth mass, and there should be having more periodontal ligament fibers. Okay, it should be where we have more periodontal fibers. That is, a rest seat should be within the confines of the greatest tooth mass, and it should not be placed on a inclined tooth surface. So inclined tooth surface we should not keep. There should not be any sharp angles. So sharp angles and inclined planes, sharp angles, and the minimum thickness is 1 mm, and there should not be any undercuts. 1 mm thickness and undercuts, there should not be any undercuts. So let's see what is the difference between primary rest and secondary or auxiliary rest. So primary rest, a rest which is a part of a retentive clasp assembly, which is known as primary rest. It prevent vertical movement of a prosthesis towards the tissues and also help transmit applied forces to the supporting teeth. And it should be shallow and saucer shaped, and should be function as ball and socket joint. You know what is ball and socket joint? So this is a socket and this is the ball. Whereas auxiliary or secondary rest, a rest that is responsible for additional support or indirect retention. It is for indirect retention or for additional support. That is known as auxiliary rest or secondary rest. They are used in the extension RPDs, such as class 1, class 2, and class 4. Class 4 will be long span cases. So in these type of extension RPDs, the secondary auxiliary rest will be used. Now let's see one by one. The first one is occlusal rest. Occlusal rest. So as you see the picture here, it is a rigid extension of removable dental processes that contacts the occlusal surface of a tooth, or a restoration, or the occlusal surface of which may have been prepared to receive it. So you can see the form is a triangular shape where the base is the marginal ridge and apex is towards the center. You can see the mesiodistal diameter of a rest, that is 1/3 to 1/2 of the mesiodistal diameter. So the rest should be in that dimension, and the buccolingual dimension, it should be 1/2 of the total buccolingual width. And regarding the ankylation is very important. So angle formed by the occlusal rest and the vertical minor connector should be less than 90 degree. So you can see this is less than 90 degree. So when the rest seat is less than 90 degree and more than 90 degree, you can clinically understand it using an explorer. So when you probe it proximally, the explorer will not slip off if the angulation is less than 90 degree, and explorer will slip off the rest seat if it is pulled proximally if the angulation is greater than 90 degree. And less than 90 degree, it is a positive rest seat. If it is more than 90 degree, it is not a positive one. And the floor of the occlusal rest seat, there should be a reduction of the marginal ridge to a depth of 1.5 millimeter. Now let's see how do we prepare occlusal rest in a sound enamel, in an existing restoration or a new restoration, or in a crown, inlays, onlays. So when we prepare a rest seat in a sound enamel, the preparation of rest seat always must follow proximal preparation, never precede it. So proximal preparation should be first, okay, then only the rest seat. Should never forget, proximal preparation should be first, then we can do the rest seat. second. First should be the proximal preparation, then the rest seat. So the occlusal rest seat in sound enamel may be prepared with diamond points of approximately the size of number 6 and 8 round burrs, or even you can use carbide burrs. Whereas the occlusal rest seat preparation in existing restoration is same as in enamel. There is a proximal preparation should be first, then rest seat should be placed. Rest seat preparation in amalgam should be avoided because of the creep problem. Whereas the occlusal rest seat in new restoration, they should be placed in the wax pattern. So the location of the occlusal rest should be shown when the tooth is prepared for a crown or an inlay, so that the sufficient clearance may be provided in the preparation for the rest. Whereas the occlusal rest seat in crown, inlays or onlays. Okay, so crown, inlays or onlays. So most ideal way of getting a positive support, it is indicated in rotated inclined tooth, mandibular bicuspid with rudimentary cusp, or tooth with abrasion. So these are generally made larger and deeper than the enamel, and those made in abutment crowns supporting tooth bone dentures may be slightly deeper than those in abutment supporting a distal extension base. That is, a abutment crown supporting tooth bone dentures, they will be slightly deeper than those in abutment supporting a distal extension case. Okay, so the tooth bone cases will be having slightly deeper than the distal extension case. So what are the types of occlusal rests? The first one is internal occlusal rest. Internal occlusal rest. I'll just put OR, that is occlusal rest. So see the picture here. A totally tooth supported partial denture may use internal occlusal rest for tooth occlusal support and horizontal stabilization. So the occlusal support is derived from the floor of the rest seat and from an additional occlusal bevel if provided. So the horizontal stabilization is from the near vertical walls of this type of rest seat. It should be parallel to the path of placement, slightly tapered occlusally. You can see the slight tapering here, and dovetailed to prevent dislodgement proximally. What are the advantages of this internal occlusal rest? That it facilitates the elimination of a visible clasp arm buccally. That is the most common problem we face with the rest occlusal visibility. So this will not be visible, and permits the location of the rest seat in a more favorable position in relation to the tipping axis of the abutment because it is inside. The second one is long or continuous rest. So the rest can be designed to extend entirely across the occlusal surface of two or more teeth, and in some instances across the entire arch. You can see here, when occlusal force is delivered in one area, all the remaining teeth act in unison to provide support because it is a single framework. So with planning, this type of rest can restore the occlusal plane, provide support and splint the arch. The third one is ring rest. So for clinical situation, with a buccally inclined maxillary molar serving as a distal terminal abutment for a RPD. Okay, so buccally inclined maxillary molar, which serves as a distal terminal abutment for a RPD, the use of a ring rest with a long guiding plane can be considered as a cost-effective and efficient alternative design option. So this is a scenario. Can use it in this scenario where the maxillary molar, which is buccally inclined, act as a distal terminal abutment. Next one is interproximal occlusal rest. Interproximal occlusal rest, which is also known as empressure rest. The design of a direct retainer assembly may require that interproximal occlusal rest be used. So these are prepared as individual but adjoining occlusal rest seats, as you see here, and preparations must be extended further lingually. And adjacent rests rather than a single rest are used to avoid interproximal wedging by the framework. So also to shun the foot away from the contact points, and we should take care to avoid eliminating contact point of abutment teeth. And sufficient tooth structure must be removed to allow for adequate bulk of the components to be so shaped that occlusion will not be altered. Whereas the fifth one is extended occlusal rest, which is indicated in Kennedy's class 2 modification 1, Kennedy's class 3 situations, when the most posterior abutment is a mesially tipped molar. So this rest should extend more than one half of the mesial distal width of the tooth. It should be approximately one third of the buccolingual width of the tooth, and it should allow for a minimum of 1 millimeter thickness of the metal, and the preparation should be rounded with no undercuts or sharp angles. So that was all about the occlusal rest. So we learned internal occlusal rest, long continuous rest, ring rest, interproximal or empressure rest, or extended occlusal rest. So this can be alone asked as a short essay or short note. So it is very important, this rest and rest seat. And previously we were discussing how to prepare rest seat on enamel, on onlay, crown, existing restoration or a new restoration. All are important. Now we have the lingual or cingulum rest. Lingual or cingulum rest, a metallic extension of a partial removable dental processes framework that fits into a prepared depression within an abutment tooth's lingual surface. So lingual or cingulum rests are used primarily on maxillary canines. So the thickness of enamel on the lingual surface of mandibular canine rarely allows a lingual rest to be used. That is why it is mostly on the maxillary canines. Lingual rest provides improved aesthetics. That is the most striking or attractive feature of lingual or cingulum rest. The outline form, as you see picture here, a slightly rounded V is prepared on the lingual surface at the junction of the gingival and middle one third of the tooth. You can see the V here. The apex of the V is directed incisally. The proximal view demonstrates the correct angulation of the floor of the rest seat. It should be less than 90 degrees. You can see from mesial, occlusal and all aspects. So the mesio distal length of the preparation should be minimum of 2.5 to 3 mm and labiolingual width about 2 mm. This is labiolingual, this is mesiodistal, and incisoapical depth minimum of 1.5 mm. Okay, so the mesiodistal should be 2.5 to 3 mm, labiolingual should be 2 mm, and incisoapical depth should be minimum of 1.5 mm. So it is located closer to the rotational center of the supporting tooth and does not tend to tip the tooth. Sometimes we need to follow a round lingual seat form, that is mesial of the canine teeth, when typical cingulum rest is contraindicated because of any large restoration, lack of clearance with the opposing teeth or poor cingulum. So we might go with a round lingual seat form, which should be a spoon shaped, similar to occlusal rest seat, and it is more difficult due to the incline of the lingual surface. And Lingual rest seat on a cast restoration. Okay, when we do this on a cast restoration, when a crown is to be placed on an anterior tooth and a rest seat is required, the rest seat should be placed in the wax pattern first. The floor of the rest seat is readily carved to be the most apical portion of the preparation. A saddle-like shape which provides a positive rest seat located favorably in relation to the long axis of the tooth. So the framework of the denture is made to fill out the continuity of the lingual surface so that the tongue contacts the smooth surface without the patient being conscious of the bulk or the irregularities of this rest. And the lingual rest may be placed on the lingual surface of a cast veneer crown, a three-quarter crown, an inlay or a laminate veneer or a composite restoration. So that was all about the lingual or cingulum rest. So we finished the occlusal rest and lingual rest. Now we have the third one, that is incisal rest. So incisal rest are placed at the incisal angles of the anterior teeth, which is less desirable than lingual rest and rest seats for anterior teeth. Nevertheless, they may be used successfully if abutment are sound and cast restorations are not indicated. So the incisal rest may be used on a canine abutment in either arch, but the cingulum can be used only on the upper arch. So this incisal rest is more applicable to the mandibular canine. Okay. So this type of rest provides definite support with relatively little loss of tooth structure and little display of metal, unlike the occlusal rest. So the labial view demonstrate inclination of the floor of the rest seat, which allow forces to be directed along the long axis of the tooth as nearly as possible. Can see the floor of the rest seat, which is helping the force to be in a direction that is parallel to the long axis of the tooth. And the proximal edge of the rest seat is rounded rather than straight. The lingual view shows that all borders of the rest seat are rounded to avoid any sharp line angles. It should appear as a small V-shaped notch located approximately 1.5 to 2 mm from the proximal incisal angle. You can see here. The deepest part of the preparation should be toward the center of the tooth mesiodistally. The notch should be rounded and should extend slightly onto the facial surface to provide a positive seat for the rest. So that was about incisal rest. So that was all about rests and rest seats. So this session was basically about the occlusal, lingual or cingulum or incisal rest seat. So it can be asked as a long essay, short essay or short note. Anything can be asked as a short note. The occlusal rest or its type, lingual or cingulum rest, incisal rest, its rest seat preparation on enamel, cast restoration or crown or anything. So always draw picture. It is very helpful when you draw picture and shows the angulation and the size and shape of the rest seat rather than writing up the same thing in paragraphs. So hope you understood this concept of rests and rest seats. So I'll come up with a new topic in prosthodontics. Thank you.